how we love you, Father. How we love you, Jesus. How we love your presence. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. How we love you, Father. How we love you, Jesus. How we love your presence, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit. How we love you, Father. How we love you, Jesus. How we love your presence. Holy Spirit. Oh, Holy Spirit. Oh, and happy are the people whose God is Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in. Happy are the people whose God is Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in. The people whose God is Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in you. Happy are the people whose God is Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in you. Happy are the people whose God is Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in you. Oh, happy are the people whose God is Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in you. Happy are the people whose God is Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in you. In you alone we trust. In you alone we put our trust. In you alone we put our trust. Oh, and happy are the people whose God is Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in you. Happy are the people whose God is Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in you. Oh, you set my feet to dance. You fill my heart with joy. But you set my feet to dance. You fill my heart with joy. Would you set my feet dancing? You fill my heart with joy. You set my feet dancing. You fill my heart with joy. For all of your goodness, all of your goodness, but all of your goodness, all of your goodness. Oh. You set my feet a dance. You fill my heart with joy. You set my feet a dance. You fill my heart with joy. You set my feet a dance. You fill my heart with joy. You set my feet a dance. You fill my heart with joy. For all of your goodness. All of your goodness, oh, all of your goodness, the people whose God is the Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in you. Oh, happy are the people whose God is the Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in you. Oh, happy are the people whose God is the Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in you. What fellowship, what joy divine, that I am Jesus's and he is mine. What blessedness, what peace so free, that I'm in Jesus and he's in me. And it's great, great joy, it's great, great peace. Oh, it's the peace of all fruits of righteousness and only increase. Oh, it's great, great joy, it's great, great peace. Oh, it's the peace of all fruits of righteousness and only increase. My silver gray, I serve the King of glory. I'm for him and he's for me. Fellowship, what joy divine, that I am Jesus's and he is mine. With blessedness, what peace so free, that I'm in Jesus and he's in me. And it's great, great joy. Oh, it's great, great peace. Oh, it's the peace of all fruits of righteousness and all the increase. Oh, it's great, great joy. And it's great, great peace. Oh, it's the peace of all fruits of righteousness and all the increase. For some are great. The Almighty, I'll serve the King of glory, and I'm for him and he's for me. Oh, I'll serve the great big God, I'll serve the Almighty, oh, I'll serve the King of glory, and I'm for him and he's for me. I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, 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 I'm leaning on the everlasting. No surer arms. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, forever. I'm leaning on the everlasting. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Your arms of love, your arms of love, your arms of love, your arms of love. Trusting in Jesus, trusting in Jesus, trusting in Jesus, trusting. Trusting in Jesus, only in Jesus. Yes, I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, 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 I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Trusting in Jesus, trusting in Jesus.
Of the Almighty, I'm still the King of.
that I'm in Jesus and He's in. Oh, what fellowship, what joy and divine. Oh, that I am Jesus' and He is mine. Oh, what blessedness. Oh, what peace so free. Oh, that I'm in Jesus and He's in. Oh, what fellowship, what joy divine, that I am Jesus's and He is mine. Oh, what blessedness. What peace so free. That I'm in Jesus and He's in. When I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Yes, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. Trusting in Jesus. Only in Jesus. Oh, I'm trusting in Jesus.
Serve the Almighty.
I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Yes, I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting. 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 Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting.
Mighty God, even the Lord, has spoken and called the earth from the rising of the sun unto the going down thereof. Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God has shined. Sing that again, Joshua. Sing it again. The Almighty God.
Everlasting arm. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Yes, I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Yes, I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arm.
Lord, we can put our trust in you. Lord, you are faithful, the Almighty God, maker of all heaven and all earth, Lord, and all that is in them. Lord, you have made it all. Lord, you've planned it all. Lord, and your salvation is perfect. Your ways are perfect. We glorify you, Lord. We can lean upon your arms. Let us never forget, God. Lord, we lean upon your arms. Lord, we put our trust in you, and we will not be ashamed. Lord, we have put our trust in you, and Lord, you will fulfill all your will and all your purposes. Lord, we put our trust in you. Hallelujah. Great and mighty are you, O Lord. Great and mighty, O God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Everybody shout unto the Lord. Just begin to praise him. Oh, hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. We praise you. Oh, Lord, yes. Lord, you're so wonderful. Lord, you're so glorious. Lord, you're so faithful. Lord, you're so loving. Lord, your care is so great. Lord, we honor you. What a place to be gathered together with your people that will praise you, that will glorify you, that will sing unto your name, will tell of all your wondrous works. Oh, how wonderful you are.
Oh God, my God and my King. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. You can be seated if you desire. Thank you, everybody. The Lord, He is wonderful. I read a little Psalms 50. It was kind of amazing. I heard that song. I was just going, oh, Psalms 50. The mighty God, even the Lord, has spoken and called the earth from the rising of the sun unto the going down thereof. Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God has shined. And then it goes on, our God, He shall come, and He will not keep silent. A fire shall devour before Him, and it shall be very tempestuous round about Him. He shall call to the heavens from above and to the earth, that He may judge His people. Gather my servants together unto me, those that have made a covenant with me by sacrifice. And the heavens shall declare His righteousness, for God is judge Himself. Selah. It's pretty intense. You made a covenant with Him by sacrifice? A sacrifice of Jesus. We no longer bring bulls and goats and heifers and those kind of sacrifices, turtle doves. But the sacrifice of Jesus, we've made a covenant with Him. But this is a covenant that does not depend upon you and it does not depend upon me. It is a covenant that depends solely upon Him. He has done great things. He has done mighty things. He has made a covenant with us that cannot be wiped away. This covenant cannot be changed. This covenant cannot be violated. It will not happen. Cannot be. You want to violate it, you're not in it. It's that simple. And all you have to do is say yes to His sacrifice, and you're in the covenant. And all those glorious things. So I was going to read a little further in here. Let's go down to verse 15. It's got a lot of things on my heart, a lot of things to talk about. We'll see. Verse 14, we'll say, Psalms 50. Offer unto God thanksgiving and pay thy vows unto the Most High. Lord, I thank you. Thank you for your blessings. Thank you for your provision. Lord, I thank you for everything that you've given unto me. I thank you for the healing that you've brought to me. Oh, God. Verse 15, I will call and call upon me, God says, in the day of trouble, and I will deliver you, and you will glorify me. Don't trust in the arm of flesh to deliver you. Don't trust in man to get you out of your trouble. Don't trust in your ability to think, your ability to plan, your ability to gain, your ability to do anything. Don't trust in that, but call upon the Lord. It's really one of the things He just wants from us. Is when we have trouble, Lord, I don't have enough food to eat. Lord, I don't have enough money to buy. Lord, I don't have a roof over my head. Lord, I don't have any of these things. He tells us not even worry about those. He says, come to me and ask of me what? Does He really want us to ask Him? I mean, that's fine up to a point. Lord, I want to have these things. He says, take no thought for those things. So what's He talking about? Call upon me in the day of trouble. What's happening to you in the day of trouble? You're sore pressed because the powers of darkness are doing everything they can to undermine you. They're doing everything they can to bring doubt to you. They're doing everything they can to tell you it isn't going to work. They're doing everything they can to tell you, well, you really don't need to be that radical. In that trouble, that's trouble. You want to be in trouble? Begin to let doubt and unbelief creep into your life and into your mouth and into the words you speak. That'll bring you trouble. But you know what? When you're in that kind of trouble, you can call upon the name of the Lord. You know what He does? He delivers you. He'll deliver you. He's so faithful. He will deliver you. No matter what the problem, no matter what's going on with you. We get so focused on the time of troubles when I don't have enough to eat. God told me not to think about that. Time of troubles when I don't have enough money. God said, your money perish with you. Don't even need it. The time of trouble is that the devil is going to do everything he can to lie to you. He's going to tell you you're no good. He's going to tell you you failed. He's going to tell you nobody likes you. He's going to tell you they wish you'd just go away. The world would be better off without you. Whatever it might be, that's trouble. That's trouble. I lived there a long time ago, all the days of my life, in misery, always depressed, always unhappy, always feeling like there had to be something more on the other side of another fence, around the corner of another place, up on top of a different mountain, whatever it might be, living in that kind of trouble. That's trouble. That's the real trouble God's calling about. I don't know why I got off on all that, but hey, the Lord knows. I call upon me in the day of trouble. He says, I'll deliver you. I'll deliver you. You will glorify me. You know, he provides, he gives blessing, filling your heart with food and gladness. Who gets that blessing? Who gets that blessing? The just and the unjust, the righteous and the wicked can have that blessing. That's why we're not even worried about that stuff. The rain falls. Jesus said it on the just and the unjust. He says, but you be perfect. Amen. Oh my, perfect. Lord, you call me to be perfect. Perfect in what? Complete and utter trust in him. That means that when I'm in trouble, I call upon him. Amen. When I feel like it's not working out for me, I call upon him. Because what I'll usually find out when I call upon him is I've been trusting in me. And therefore, it doesn't work out for me. That's a problem. We don't want to do that. And I will deliver you, and then what are you going to do? I glorify you, Lord, because you brought me out. You might look at a situation and think you brought yourself out. You didn't. You didn't. Well, I finally figured out what the problem was. Got my thinking straight. Now I'm better off than I was before. No. I called upon the name of the Lord, said, Lord, I'm in trouble. Obviously, what's happening in my life isn't right. Lord, I'm in trouble. He delivers me. Every time I call upon him, it's a promise to me. Verse 16, but unto the wicked. Anybody here is wicked? I was looking around. I couldn't find any wicked. God says, what have you to do to declare my statutes so that you should take my covenant in your mouth? Oh my. The wicked, they shouldn't even be talking about God and about his covenant. Shouldn't even be talking about it. Just who do you think you are even talking about it? Seeing you hate instruction and you cast my words behind you like the dust of your feet. See, the word is a light into our path. It's right before us. We're following it. The wicked, they cast it behind them. So they don't have to follow it. They don't have to look at it. When you saw a thief, you consented with him, and you've been partaker with adulterers, and you give your mouth to evil and your tongue frames deceit. We don't have anybody like that here. You sit and speak against your brother. You slander your own mother's sons. These things you have done, and I kept silent. You thought that I was altogether such a one as yourself, but I will reprove thee and set them in order before thine eyes. Now consider this, ye that forget God, lest I tear you in pieces. And there is no one to deliver you. It's the contrast. See, I call upon the name of the Lord. When I'm in trouble, he delivers me. There's no one to deliver the wicked. Whoso offers praise glorifies me. And to him that orders his conversation aright, will I show the salvation of God. Set my conversation aright. I don't put my trust in me. I don't put my trust in any ability I imagine that I have. Because everything I have, whatever it may be, is from God. It's what he's made me, what he made you. And he's given you a mouth to praise. So you praise him. So you give thanks unto him. He's not asking you for much. He really isn't. You know, he's not asking us to be great in ourselves. He's not asking us to climb to the highest mountain or talk to the tallest tree or to move the biggest roadblock out of the way. He's just asking us to praise him. He's just asking us to call upon him when we're in trouble. First thing, you got to recognize I'm in trouble. My life isn't lining up with the word. Lord, you told me I was healed. Father, I'm not feeling healed. What's wrong? I'm in trouble. It says, call on my name. Okay, Lord, I'm calling on you. I'm in trouble. I'm healed. Because he delivers me. Hallelujah. What a song. Almighty God, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. I mean, the Almighty God wants to be your protector. He wants to be your keeper. He wants to be your defense, your rock, your strong tower. He is all those things to me. The Almighty God, the one who made heaven and earth. That's it. He's Almighty. I could just sit there and sing, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. I was feeling so good with that. I just go, yes, Lord, I'm leaning on your arms. I get to see babies all day, and they're always leaning in their mother's arms. It's like Naomi there. She's cuddled up in her mother's arms asleep. She's protected. She's comforted. It ought to be a baby again. No, not really. But. So, where did I want to go? 1 Thessalonians. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for your leading. We thank you for your keeping. Lord, we thank you for your word. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for all that you do. Father, we thank you this is a Pentecostal church. Father, we thank you that it's praying in tongues, it's prophecy. Lord, it's all the gifts of the Spirit, words of wisdom, words of knowledge, faith, gifts of healing. Lord, all those things resident in your church by Jesus, by the moving of the Holy Ghost. Lord, you've given it unto us. It's not some dead, dry place. Lord, it's a Pentecostal church. No matter what the demographics would tell you. Hallelujah. How do you even begin? Let's go to chapter 3. Let's go to verse 9. Let's go to verse 8. For now we live, if you stand fast in the Lord. So we're going to be talking about standing fast in the Lord. I already talked about the fact you call upon him in the day of trouble, he'll deliver you. And he'll do it again, and he'll do it again, and he'll do it again. And you're going to get used to being delivered. Because you're going to get used to not trusting in yourself. And he's always going to be the one to get you out. He's always going to be the one that makes the way. And then you'll get to the place where you don't have to so much be delivered, is that he's always the one that's moving things out of the way in front of you as you're following his word. He's moving stuff out of the way. He's just, you're seeing a wall in the way, and you're saying, Father, I speak to the wall of faith. Get it out of the way. Father, grace, get it out of the way. Okay, I'm going to keep on going. That's proactive. No longer having to be sitting in the defensive position warding off the fact the enemy's bombing you. God will deliver you over and over. But how about we take that offensive position where the gates of hell don't prevail against us? Where we begin to see the gates of hell, and instead of being accepting of them, we can have faith for people to remain as they are. That is not good. But we, many times, that's where we live. We look at people, well, there's nothing I can do about it. There's nothing I can do to change it. They're just that way, and there's nothing I can do to make them better. There's nothing. That's true, there's nothing you can do, but you can begin to speak to the mountain. You can begin to see people in need that are stuck in where they're at, and you begin to say, in Jesus' name, break off every binding thing, everything that's against it, every mind-blinding spirit, everything stopping up their ears, everything that does not allow them to see, does not allow them to hear. We begin to go after that. They take the offensive position now, and we begin to break people free. But we haven't done that like we should, because we've been content to believe that they'll remain the same as they are, instead of being understanding that we need to believe they're not going to be the same as they are. They're going to change. First testimony you need to remember is your own. I got delivered. It's silly when you think about it. It took about a year. I got hungry for God because of what I saw in some other people, but I didn't really understand. I began to seek after him, but I didn't know where to go. And because I was the only person in the entire church that was seeking after anything, they thought I was something special. So they sent me to a conference. I go to the conference, and I'm in a hotel room, and a guy comes in, and he gets out the Bible. This was a new revelation. There's actually a Bible that you can read. And he begins to read the scripture to me, that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, that the gift of God is eternal life, and whosoever believes on him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And such like scriptures begins to teach us to be, and my life became radically changed. That's a miracle. It was an absolute miracle. From depression to joy that I didn't understand and I didn't know how to express. And I got home and everybody thought I was crazy and something was wrong with me and I was different than I'd ever been before. And I didn't know how to tell them what was going on. I didn't know how to tell them. I just didn't know. I didn't have the words. But I was different. That testimony, you all have a testimony of such like. And if you don't, you need to get up here and get saved. Okay? So you have a testimony. You should have a testimony that you remember when you knew. You may have had five testimonies where five different times you feel like you've run to the altar and God really made a difference in your life. I don't know what you've got, each of you. But the point is you need to have a testimony. And this is important because when we look at this, if you stand fast in the Lord, your testimony is the first thing you know about. If you can believe that it happened to you, you can believe it happened to somebody else. Right? It's going to happen to them. Amen. We're going to stop being content to leave people the way they are. Live and let live. Won't bother them. And we're going to get after breaking off the strongholds so they're going to be different. And they're going to have a radical testimony just like you got. Right? So verse 9, what thanks can we render to God again for you? For all the joy wherewith we joy for your sakes before our God. Isn't that wonderful? You think about the fact that, you know, when you go home, you think about all your brothers and sisters here, and you can just rejoice in God for every one of them. Just rejoice in God for people that are hungry to seek after him. He goes, what thanks can we render to God again? We're so thankful and joyful for just knowing your faith, basically. Verse 10, night and day we're praying exceedingly that we might see your face and might perfect that which is lacking in your faith. Now God himself and our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ direct our way unto you. He's telling them, I'd love to come see you in the flesh. I'd love to come and minister to you. The Lord make you to increase and abound in love one toward another and toward all men, even as we do towards you. So that same rejoicing, do you love one another like that? When you see each one, this is a really interesting perspective, let me tell you. It's so different from sitting over there. Because I get to see everybody and everything everybody's doing. And I can look at all the faces and all the people and I can begin to rejoice for that one and that one and that one and that one. I'm so thankful for everyone. So blessed that everyone is here. You know, it's an interesting thought. I'm not looking at the back of people's heads. I'm looking at their faces. It's great. And it's a wonderful thing. The Lord make you to increase and abound in love one toward another. I pray tonight that you would increase and abound in love one toward another. Every one of you love one toward another. To the end, he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness before God, even our Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all his saints. He wants you unblameable in holiness. That's his desire for you. That's the desire of everyone who knows God who's praying for you, that you be unblameable in holiness. So who's my holiness? Jesus is my holiness. Jesus, you are all of my wisdom. You're my righteousness. Oh, Jesus, you're my sanctification, my holiness. Jesus, you are my redemption. When I'm in trouble, I call upon you. That's who he is. That's the end of 1 Corinthians chapter 1. He's all those things to me. He's all of that. I need wisdom, I call upon Jesus. I need sanctification. I need to be set apart. I need holiness. He's telling me, I'm praying for you that you be unblameable in holiness after God, even our Father. Oh, he's right. Jesus is all that to me. He's all that to me. All I have to do is call upon his name and I receive. If I feel like my holiness is lacking, I haven't been set apart like I should, do I get upset? Pressed. No, I call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, deliver me. And we know he's going to call me to. We already know what he's going to tell me to do. Come. Begin to give thanks. Begin to praise me. If you need to repent, I tell you to repent. And here's my word. Here's your praise. Here's your mouth. Give praise. That's all. I mean, it's a simple thing. It's all he's going to ask you to do. And then he says, now come fellowship. Love the brethren. Right? And he's going to tell us these things. Oh, it's so good. So we were going to talk about stand fast. I'm still trying to get to where I wanted to be. Father, in Jesus' name. Furthermore, verse 1 of chapter 4, 1 Thessalonians. Furthermore, then, we beseech you, brethren. Furthermore, we beseech you. There's something else that he wants to come at us with. And exhort you by the Lord Jesus that as you have received of us how you ought to walk and please God, so you would abound more and more. This is the job, the perfecting of the saints. See, he's talking to the saints. He's not talking to the wicked. He's talking to the saints, the holy ones. And he's praying for them. But he's beseeching them now, above and beyond all that. He's beseeching them and exhorting them by the Lord Jesus to walk and please God and abound more and more in it. It's intense. We get a lot of that here. We're being beseeched by the Holy Ghost to walk and please God. Right? What's the first thing we know about pleasing God? Without faith, it's impossible to please Him. I can't please Him looking at people and having, quote, faith for them to stay the way they are. Or doubt and unbelief that they'll stay the way they are. I can't, that's not faith. I can't please God there. I can only please God when I'm acting in faith, His faith. Where's His faith come from? It comes by the Word of God. I got to hear it and I got to do it. Hearing it's good, but I got to act upon it. I got to begin to follow it. So when He tells me to rejoice, what do? I rejoice. He tells me to give thanks. What do? I give thanks. All right. For you know what commandments we gave you by the Lord Jesus. Forgive me. For this is the will of God, even your sanctification, that you should abstain from fornication. Whoa, wait a minute. We don't have that problem here, do we? You should abstain from such. He's going to start laying out holiness. Remember, he was praying for them that they would abound in holiness. You should abstain. That every one of you should know how to possess his vessel in sanctification and honor. He's telling everyone, stay away from it in all its forms. Not in the lust of concupiscence, even as the Gentiles, which don't know God. They don't know him. That's why they run to go do these things and take pleasure in them. That no man go beyond and defraud his brother in any matter. As he's beseeching you now, no defrauding. When you love people, you never defraud them. You never lie to them. Never. Because the Lord is the avenger of all such, as we also have forewarned you and testified. For God has not called us to uncleanness, but unto holiness. This message needs to be preached all around the church. And they begin to understand that it's wonderful to know how much God loved me and how much He cared. He called me and He said, call me in the day of trouble, I'll deliver you. You're in sin, I'll deliver you. Repent, I'll deliver you. It's a wonderful thing. It is great. But He's saying to the church, now I beseech you, church, so that you can walk right. You got to get yourself right. Not by your own strength. Call upon me. I'll make you right. Okay? But we gotta understand that the scripture is full of this message. Yes, I called you like you are to make you like me. And in him is no darkness, no shadow of turning, no sin. None. It is not ever acceptable. You cannot dress it up, put enough lipstick on it. No Rodan and Fields thing will ever make it acceptable. It ain't going to happen. You cannot take sin and dress it up. It's ugly from beginning to end. And it must be destroyed. All sin must be destroyed. It cannot be allowed to remain. Hallelujah. Verse 8, he therefore that despises not man, but God, who has also given unto us his holy Spirit. So anybody who despises this message, anybody who says, no, we don't have to walk that holy. No, we don't have to walk without sin. You don't despise man. You despise God. You're basically doing, you're spitting in his face. That's really the way I read this. You're looking at God and spitting in his face because you are going to do it your way. And you're going to have your sin and say that his way is despised. I despise those people that are saying they're holy. And that's what happened. And this is intense because this is what's going on all around us. Churches all over the place. What's going on? Verse 9, but as touching brotherly love, you need not that I write unto you, for you yourselves are taught of God to love one another. Now, why did he repeat that? And we're just talking about love up there and how we love one another. And then he talked about sin real intently, talked about despising God. Then he says, but you guys are all taught to love one another. What does love do? I will tell you this right now. Love will not allow sin. Love will not justify it. Love will not accept it. It will not. Love. Why? You love people too much. You just love them. And if you love them and you love one another, you're not going to allow it. You're just not going to allow it. And verse 10, and indeed you do it toward all the brethren, which are in all Macedonia, but we beseech you, brethren. It's more beseeching. You increase more and more. I want you to love more than you've ever loved before. I've been here before. I've talked many times here about when the Abiding Place first began. And one of my favorite songs, love one another even as I have loved you, fulfill you my joy and live in righteousness too. You know, it was just one of my absolute favorites. Carried me through years of school and whatever else. Just knowing that this was the call of God. And it was how we began. Love one another. Now he's beseeching us. Love one another even more than you already did before. I've heard Geneva up here crying by the Spirit of the Lord, loving one another. Heard it multiple times. You're like, well, I already knew that. He's telling them. It's right here. This is how the scripture works. I thank God you love one another. You need to love one another. I beseech you that you love one another even more than you have before. That's intense. And study to be quiet. That does not mean you come to church and be silent, please. Don't get the wrong idea. And do your own business and work with your own hands as we commanded you. So he told them about this, and he's just reminding them. So what's he talking about? He's talking about take care of your business. That's fine. Don't be riotous about such things. Okay, that's what he's talking about. But you come to church, you have full reign to shout and praise the Lord all you want. That you may walk honestly toward them that are without, and that you may lack of nothing. All those people that are outside of our fellowship, we love one another so much, we need to walk honestly with them. Never lie, never defraud them either. But I'd not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. And this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Just had to throw that part in. So we're talking about, standing fast in the Lord. Standing fast. Saying, Lord, I want to do everything right before you. And he's beseeching us to do everything right before him. But I've learned that when I'm in trouble, I call upon him. I've learned that when I trust in myself, I will fail. But when I trust in him, I'm always triumphant in Christ. Right? I begin to learn these things. It begins established in my life. No matter how long it takes. Don't worry, he's going to establish you. Just call upon him. Oh, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Let's turn to Acts 14, I think it is. Paul and Barnabas are in Iconium. Lystra. They're at Lystra. And they do a mighty miracle. A man that was crippled from his mother's womb, had never walked. He gets up, and so the people get pretty excited by the miracle. And what do? They begin to try to offer sacrifice to Paul and Barnabas, calling by the name of their Greek gods. And verse 15, Paul is crying out to people, stop, saying, sirs, why do you do these things? We also are men of like passions with you. We have all the same weaknesses of flesh that you have, all the same desires that you have, all of them. And we preach unto you that you should turn from these vanities unto the living God, which made heaven and earth and the sea and all things that are therein. Right? God, the Almighty God who made everything. This is what we're calling. We're calling you to Him. We're calling you to this Almighty God, who in times past suffered all nations to walk in their own ways. He allowed nations to walk in their own ways. In time past, He did. He had one nation, Israel, that He worked with. Everybody else, He just allowed them to go in their own ways. They could come to the light. They could come to Israel. They could come and hear from God. I mean, there was the leper from Syria that comes down and he gets healed. There were the woman from Zarephath. There's a lot of people in the Old Testament that came from other places. And, you know, history has tried to destroy the fact that Israel was a big deal in the time of Solomon, in the time of David, and afterwards. I mean, it was huge. It was a big deal as a nation. But we won't go there. So he suffered all nations to walk in their own ways. Nevertheless, he left not himself without a witness. Always, God always had a witness for everybody. Here was his witness in that he did good. He gave us rain from heaven and fruitful seasons, filling our hearts with food and gladness. He did that for who? Everyone. He did it for everyone. So why Jesus said, take no thought for these things. The Lord knows that you have need of these things. That's the easy stuff. Why are we caught up in the easy stuff? God's called us to holiness. God's called us to love. He's called us to thanksgiving. We need to give ourselves to those things with as much intensity as you give yourself to your next meal. I mean, really. Because he gives that to everybody. And with these sayings, verse 18, they scarce restrained the people that they would not do sacrifice to them. And then some Jews come and stir up trouble, and then they end up, you know, they went from being worshipped as gods to stoned and thrown in prison. It's pretty intense. But what's he telling them? He said, look, God left not himself without a witness. Just like Jesus said, he lets the rain fall on the just and the unjust. Why are we living in a place where we're so concerned about those things? We're content. Just like too many times we've been content to let people stay the way they are, not believing that they can change. We're content to be blessed with the same blessing the wicked have and think that we're in good shape. I've got food to eat, and I got gas in my car, and I got a roof over my head. I'm blessed. Well, so does the wicked guy. In fact, he's got a bigger roof and a nicer car. True. What are we doing? Why are we focused on these things? Why do we spend so much time worried about those things? Giving ourselves to the blessing that is a blessing. I mean, the Lord said, I know you have need of these things. Take no thought for them. What is he asking us to take thought for? Take heed to your ways according to his word. So we know we need to take heed unto the word, right? Yes. We know that we need to give thanks. We know that we're being beseeched to walk in holiness. And we know that we're being beseeched to love one another more and more. Why aren't we putting our intense concentration on those things? Because do you know the same God who causes the rain to fall on the just and the unjust causes these blessings of love and joy and peace and long-suffering and meekness and faith, all of these things, to fall upon the righteous. There's a blessing for the righteous that we can have. All we have to do is receive it. All we have to do is accept it. And if we put as much effort into that blessing as we put into the blessings that the wicked also have, wouldn't we be much better off? That's why Jesus said, take no thought for these things, but seek ye first the kingdom of God. What's the kingdom of God made up of? Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Right? That. Give yourself to those things. And if you find yourself outside of those things, that righteousness is not in your life like it should be, that peace is not reigning there, that joy is not overwhelming you, you're in trouble. And what do you do when you're in trouble? You call unto the Lord. And He delivers you out of your trouble. And He's telling you, this is what I want. I want you to put your trust in me. That's what He wants. It's simple. Glorify Him as God. What did the people do wrong in Romans? You read in Romans and it'll take you through the detail. What happened to people? And if you go there, you're reading about the Jew, the religious people. Most. He had to convince them all of what happened. But what's he telling them? He says, they turned their thoughts towards their own things and they began to worship the creation more than the Creator. And because they did that, God allowed them to be given over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are horrendous. So that's my translation. Bad things. Really bad things. And yet in the church today, all those things that are listed that are really bad things are accepted as normal in the believer today. God doesn't want us like that. Do you realize that a person who's not walking in holiness cannot walk in peace? They cannot walk in love. They really can't walk in thanksgiving. They really can't walk in redemption either. Jesus is not unto them wisdom. He's not unto them sanctification. He's not unto them righteousness. And He's certainly not unto them anything that would be of the gifts of the Holy Ghost. He's not unto them those things. So who is? The prince in the power of the air, who appears as an angel of light to deceive, causing them to walk in darkness, and they call that their light? If the light that is in you is darkness, how great is the darkness? So is there any hope for these that preach these things and do these things and live in these places? Are we content to allow them to remain as they are?
No,
we're not. Is it great persuasive words of men's wisdom that's going to convince them of the folly of their ways?
No,
it's not. What's going to change them? The what? The administration of power. What else? The demonstration. But what else? What else is going to change them? Change them. It's going to be you laying down your life. I'm going to tell you right now. That's what it's going to take. You're going to have to lay down your life. You're going to have to stop worrying about what you're going to eat and what you're going to wear and what you're going to put on. Stop worrying about being blessed with the same blessing that the wicked get. It's a great thing. Praise the Lord for it. He knows you have need of it. Just set it aside. Now, what's he going to do? You're going to have to do. You have to lay down your life because you have to give yourself to loving. You know what happens when you give yourself to loving? That means that you give and give and give and give and give and give and give. When you find yourself taking, 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 you got a problem. You give. When you give, you lay down your life. When you lay down your life, what happens? You get blessed abundantly, but you don't realize it because you're afraid to let go of what you have. That he might give you more because you're not sure you can trust him because you're really not leaning on the everlasting arms. You're leaning on your own arm and it gets tired. And when it gets tired, you fall over and then you wonder why God isn't there. I mean, that's what happens. You know that his arms will never grow weary.
Amen.
They will never get tired. I remember carrying kids around. They're fussing, crying, whatever, carrying around and my body and my back are going, are you kidding? We're still doing this. Can't you stop, please? Can you stop? I remember it, all you current parents of young children, Believe me, some of us old people were there once too. And we've done it. And you walk and you walk and you go, Lord, I can't give anymore. I'm going to die. And I don't do something about this. You know, you've been there. When you love, though, you do it with joy. You're so happy to bless. You love that kid. I get to talk to new parents all the time. And I look at them, look at the little twinkle in their eye, and I talk to them about the fact that that kid's pretty special, huh? You never thought you'd quite feel that way. You've seen a lot of babies, and they're all kind of cute, but that one's kind of special, huh? And they all have the same responses. They're just so blown away. The how you feel, because if you tell you had one, you don't know. You just don't know, do you, Kate? You just don't know until you get one. And you go, wow, that's the greatest thing ever happened to me. This is amazing. It's pretty cool. So the Lord never grows weary. His back doesn't get tired. You know, he'll carry you. I can go, I'll pick up David, and I'll start carrying David. Do you think I could do that right now? Not anymore. I can't do that. He's too big. You know, God, he'd just pick him up and carry him. Just pick him up and carry him because he loves him so much. More than I do. And that's hard for me to believe. Every one of your kids, it's hard for you to believe. God loves him more than you do. He so loves us that he sent his only begotten son. That he bore our sins on the tree. That we might receive his healing and his redemption. Yes. That he has freely given unto us everything we need. Amen. So that we can look to the Almighty God to carry us in his arms and to love us. And that when we call unto him, he'll deliver us. Whenever we're in trouble, whenever you find yourself in a place where love is not dominating you, whenever you find yourself in a place where faith is not swelling up in you, like you just know that God's going to protect you and keep you. Whenever the peace of God is not overwhelming you to the point that nothing can affect you negatively in any way. When the love and the joy do not overwhelm you, you're in trouble. And you can call unto him and he will fill you. And then when you get to the point where you think you can't have any more joy than you already have. And you think you've reached the pinnacle of it. And somebody comes along and starts telling you you need more joy in your life, and you're thinking to them, are you kidding me? And you find out they're right, because there's a greater place of joy. And then you get there and find out that, you know what, there's more. Because remember Jesus? He was anointed with the oil of joy above all those around him. He was anointed with the oil of joy in an intense way above everybody else. And they were pretty happy. They loved Jesus. They were so excited about him. But how did he get there? He loved righteousness. Yes. And he hated iniquity. Yeah. That's why we beseech you, brethren, don't let these things be named among you. We will not be those people that look at sin and act as if it's normal and acceptable in the people of God. Because it's not. Yeah. It's not. And then people say, well, you're legalistic. No, legalistic is if I was doing that by my own strength, by keeping of the law of Moses or something. No, it's that way because he made me that way. And he made me that way because I was in trouble and I called unto him and he delivered me for his glory, that I might be set free. Now I can begin to go out of this place. And I begin to look at all of those people who I've been content to allow to remain as they are. And I can begin to say, Father, fill me with your love and your compassion. Father, fill me with the power of the Holy Ghost to break off those bonds of wickedness. The ones that I came at them with my axe and I hit and my axe bounced off. And I just went, well, there's nothing I can do. Because I've tried. I put a lot of effort into it. I could swing an axe harder than most, and it just didn't work. So I guess there's no way. And I walked away disappointed that they didn't change because I didn't believe my God. I didn't walk in faith. I was putting my trust in my ability to make a difference. I don't have any ability to make a difference. But I do have the ability to give myself to love. I do have the ability to give myself to holiness, that I might be anointed with the oil of joy greater than I've ever known, that that joy might be seen upon my face and in my life and might cause people, like caused me, to begin to wonder, wow, these people seem so happy. These people seem to have something I don't have. I'm so interested in this. I want to know more about this. So that I was prepared for a year later when somebody preached to me the gospel and the ground was good ground. And it went in and it took root and I was changed miraculously. Totally made brand new by a miracle. So I could begin to believe that, hey, maybe I swung my axe at that yoke that was binding them and it bounced off. Maybe I need to lay down my axe. Maybe I need to begin to take up God's axe. And I begin to pray, Father, in Jesus' name, break the yokes. Father, in Jesus' name, make a difference. Father, bring them to an understanding. Lord, let them have an encounter with you. Lord, that they might see your holiness and fall down and begin to declare, oh, Lord God, what have I done? And that you, Lord, might show them that all they need to do is call upon you and you deliver them. Yes. Deliver them from all their trouble. Right. Deliver them from everything that binds them. Deliver them from everything that prevents them from hearing. Father, you deliver them. All I have to do is lay down my life. Just lay down my life and stop seeking after my own and begin to say, Father, use me in the kingdom. Father, I've swung the axe so hard that my arms are tired. I've tried with my words so much that I'm tired of talking. I've done everything I know to do, and I've caught nothing. Lord, my nets are empty. Thank God they're not completely empty, but I mean, we'll just take it as far as it goes. They're empty. And he says, well, just cast them on the other side. So then I do. I'm obedient. I do what he told me to do. I don't neglect what he told me to do. I lay down my life in love. And with all the mercy of God, begin to call people to repentance. So all you have to do is repent. All I have to do is call upon the Lord and he'll deliver from all your pain. Deliver from all your pain. Oh, you didn't realize that sin that you love so much was what was causing the pain? Let me help you. If I take that thorn out of your foot, you won't be in so much pain anymore. Oh, you like the thorn. Well, let me tell you, you don't want the thorn. Trust me. Oh, but it's going to hurt when you pull it out. No, it really isn't. You're going to be so rejoicing that you're not going to miss it anymore. I know you thought you needed it. I know you thought it was important to you. But really, I'm telling you. I mean, I deal with this stuff every day in a physical realm. Trying to convince a kid you're really going to help him. You know, it's funny because I just look at Joshua. I did this to Joshua once in the bathroom at the church in Claremont. His arm wasn't working, and I popped his elbow back into place. But I've done that many times, but it doesn't feel good when you do it to people. So what you do is you have to surprise them. You have to convince them to trust you. Just relax. It's going to be okay. It really is going to be okay. Just do what I tell you. Boop, pop that thing back in, and they go, oh, that feels so much better, right? But you had to tell them. They didn't want you to touch them. Don't take away my broken elbow. I don't want you to hurt me. I can make it better. I really can. But understanding that people think they must have their sin for their identity. They must have their sin because that's where they find their pleasure. They must have their sin because they're afraid that you're going to make them do something that's too hard for them. You're going to put a 50-pound pack on their back and tell them to climb the top of Iron Mountain. That's what they think you're going to do. You're going to make their life difficult. Because standing against sin in your own strength is difficult. It hurts. It doesn't feel good. You just don't want to do it. Just give in and just go enjoy the pleasure of it that exists for a season. That's how they live. Because they don't know the love. They don't know the joy. They don't know the peace that they can have outside of their sin. So they come to Jesus. They come to church and they get salved in their iniquity and told, it's okay. We'll just leave your elbow like it is. We won't hurt you. You'll be fine. But their arm never works right until it gets fixed. God wants to take the sin away. And we are the only people that exist today in this place that I know of
there may be others that I know that can carry this, and it's going to require that we lay down our life. Sometimes we lay down our life in things that are very obvious to people, and sometimes we're laying down our life and you can't see what we're doing. But we're doing it because we love. And we love people, and especially those who, declaring the name of Jesus, are declaring a false gospel. And God will come to them, and he will judge them. And it will be ugly. It'll be incommensurate with the ugliness of what they have taught and what they have preached. But you know, they can avoid it. Right. All they have to do is call upon the name of the Lord, and he'll deliver them. So, stand fast in the Lord. Stand fast in the Lord. I just want to read one more thing. Matthew chapter 5. I quoted it a couple of times. It's in verse 45. But let's go back. Let's, oh Lord. You know, the sermon that Jesus gave, breaking into Jesus' sermon is hard. It's just hard. But verse 43, you've heard that it has been said, you will love thy neighbor and hate your enemy. You've heard this. We've talked here about how we beseech you to love one another more and more. Because I tell you, that's where it begins. If you can't love the brethren, how can you love those that are without? You can't even get started. Let's get started in here. But I say unto you, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. Pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he makes his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love them, if you love them which love you, what reward do you have? Don't even the publicans do that? Don't even the evil people do that? They get the same blessing of the rain, and they have, their hearts are filled with joy and gladness because they had a good Thanksgiving meal and whatever. I mean, those are all good things. They have all those things. But what reward do you have? Don't even the publicans the same? If you salute your brethren only, what do ye more than others? Do not even the publicans do that? Be therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. He's called us to perfect. He's called us to holiness. He's called us to love, and he's beseeched us for them. He's beseeching us. Why? Because he hates us? No, because he loves us. He's beseeching us, saying, come over here. I got the best. Come, taste it. You ever had somebody try to make you eat something you really don't want to eat? And they keep telling you, it's really good. It's the best thing. It's better than anything else. They want you to share with them in their love of that thing. Right? We beseech you. We need to beseech them. We've got something for them. Hallelujah. We got something for them. So, Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, we thank you for your healing and for your health. Lord, we thank you for your joy and for your love and for your peace. Lord, we thank you for the glory that you want to bring to your Son Jesus through every single person in this place. Lord, in the abiding place, abiding in you, abiding in the vine. Lord, that we might bring forth much fruit. Lord, if we find ourselves barren and unfruitful, Lord, we're in trouble. And we can call upon you. Lord, in every tribulation, we can rejoice. We can call upon you, whatever it may be. Father, whatever the men may do to us, we don't care. Whatever they do, will throw us in a fiery furnace. They want to beat us or stone us, throw us in prison. Father, these things are easy for us to understand, but sometimes they just despise us, and sometimes they just turn their back on us. Sometimes they scorn us and call us bad words. Father, it doesn't matter what men may do, because we love them so much, because you called us to be perfect. Lord, and in your perfectness, you loved the whole world. Even though it lied in wickedness and men were ungodly, you died for them. Father, let us do the same. Father, we thank you that we do the same. Lord, we thank you that you strengthen us to do the same. Lord, that we call upon you and that you teach us and you lead us and you guide us in everything that we need to do. Father, that every single person in here, Lord, has come to this place on a Wednesday night because they're seeking after you. Lord, they've been drawn to your joy. They've been drawn to your peace. Lord, they've been touched. They've tasted and they've seen. Father, let the word of our mouth, the meditation of our heart be acceptable unto you all day long. Let joy and love and peace be all that we desire. And Lord, let us love and let us walk in holiness. Father, by your strength, by your keeping power, in Jesus' name, we thank you for it. That from this day forward, we're not going to be content to let it just lie like it is. Not going to be. Lord, we're just not going to be. Lord, but we're going to see a change. Lord, we're going to speak to the mountains. We're going to speak to the yokes. Lord, we're going to speak to the lies. We're going to take authority over them in the spirit. Lord, we're going to loose men from their sins. We're going to loose them. Hallelujah. We're going to lay down our own axe, Father, and pick up the sword of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Which is the Word of God. Lord, we're going to stand and we're going to proclaim the Word of the Lord. The truth of it. And though men may despise us, though men may call us all sorts of despicable things, Father, we're not going to care because we're going to be perfect as our Father which in heaven is perfect. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You got loved ones close to you that need to be delivered. We pray for them right now. Now everybody shout and begin to pray for them. Father, Lord, everyone, call them back. Lord, we call them to you in Jesus' name. Let your word go forth. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Oh, saramentere mi chiesa, parma sotto de vacande. Lord, that we might have the wisdom of Christ Jesus and win souls, O Lord. Oh, so diviene macarva coramendiaca. Lord, that we would stand fast in you, unmoving, knowing what you have done for us, the greatness of your life that you have given unto us. In Jesus' name. Oh, Lord Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, God. Parma sedevi ki agaraba. Porova suramantava. Erama sorovoko ramamata. There's anybody in here that's in trouble. I don't care what the trouble is. You're in trouble. Come. We'll pray with you. We'll agree with you. I don't care what the trouble is. It doesn't matter because the Lord delivers out of trouble. He'll get you out of your trouble. He'll get you out. Maybe not the way you think of it, but he's going to get you out. Father, we thank you for the time when trouble causes us to seek after you. The time when trouble is sweet because it causes us to seek you, to know that we have need of you. Lord, we all have need of you. Everyone in here, we have need of you. Oh, in Jesus' name, I thank you, Lord, for your deliverance. Lord, I thank you for your strength. I thank you for your power. Oh,
Oh, Lord, you are so good.
Father, we thank you for your power, for your anointing.
Lord, the strengthening.
Lord, strength where there is no strength. Father, power when nothing else will do. Father, your healing strength.
I want everybody to keep praying for everybody you know. Begin to name them. Begin to call upon the Lord. Say, Father, they need to turn to you. This one needs to turn to you. That one needs to turn to you. Father, your cousins, your co-workers, people you see in the grocery store, I don't care who they are. We begin to say, Father, tonight we're going to move even further. Father, we're going to come to that place. We'll begin to make a difference. Father, in a way we've not made a difference before. Lay down our acts. Lay down our words. Give ourselves to yours. In Jesus' name.